मोशन टेस्ट इज अ सिंपल टेस्ट, डोंट ट्राई टू अमास टू मच मटेरियल बिकॉज टाइम इज वेरी लेस. 13th इज द टेस्ट, ऑल द बेस्ट फॉर यू. एंड फॉर द लास्ट 3 इयर्स द पैटर्न इज जस्ट वेरी नॉट दैट मच टफ एंड दे आर ओनली फोकसिंग ऑन फंक्शनल एस्पेक्ट्स. सो यू बी फोकस एंड ट्राई टू बिकॉज टुडे वी अपलोडेड दिस नॉलेज बैंक आल्सो इन कैनेट, दैट इज मोर देन एनफ. ओके and if possible time just read some functional aspects about Basel 3, Forex, all these things where they're asking very basic questions because 30% to 40% in any exam they're asking only very fundamental aspects. Thus you should not fumble. 30% we have seen pattern that somewhat tough where the level is. So 100% 40 stand is very basics only, that many of the people are making wrong because we are ignoring basics. 60% of questions that the level of because the difficulty is only medium. So soft and medium questions should not leave. 30 to 40 questions only, somewhat tough questions are coming in any exam. The last 3 years pattern analyzed. So you just because this promotion test is a time for refreshment, just refresh yourself all your basics only, and you'll be easily getting 40 to 50 marks. Fundamentals you'll get 50 marks definitely in any level. So that you keep in mind and proceed. Don't do because try to mug up lot of materials. And our candle is enough. Our LDC vertical material is more than enough. That is also a very voluminous book. Okay. Now, friends, I will be taking about. I will be covering. I will be assisting you only in updating your forex. Many of you are ignoring. In 2-3 sessions. Schedule is 2 only. If time is not there, any topics are to be covered. I will take one more session. So as of now, today and Saturday, I will cover basic aspects of forex. Today I will cover very basics because from exam point of view only, not that good. And Saturday I will be covering exam part of forex. Okay. So simply is why forex is required now, because you need forex to buy and world goods, all these things. From exam point of view. So why forex? Because a lot of regulations are there. You must be well aware. Forex transactions are governed by FEMA. FEMA is the governing. India's the FEMA is the. This is whatever you are doing at branch level. FEMA compliance is very important. Who issues FEMA? Who issues? It is the Government of India statute. So FEMA is issued by Government of India. Who implements FEMA in India? RBI is the custodian of FEMA. So because who issues the forex rules? FEDA issues the rules of business. Because you should know what is who. Who is who in forex? Government of India. Ministry of Finance and Ministry of Commerce are the nodal agencies for forex. Ministry of Finance, Government of India issued FEMA Act. The statute is made by Government of India. RBI implement the FEMA Act. FEMA Act is the fulcrum of Indian foreign exchange transactions. Then all foreign exchange transactions are governed by FEDA rules. Very important. FEDA rules also, every session we are getting 2-3 questions from FEDA rules. Then FEMA also, FEMA common goal, what is residential status, all common questions, simple questions you should not ignore. And NR deposits also, because from foreign exchange, in all the exams, all levels of exams, last 3 years we analyzed around 10 to 15 questions are coming, basing on the level. So the foreign exchange questions are not that much tough when compared to other topics. So please spare some time for this topic. In this one material also, we have covered almost all topics. It 15 marks easily you can get in at all levels. Minimum 15, around 15 you are getting. So RBI, FEDA norms, and when comes to trading part, DGFT and Indian customs are the authorities. So that because all foreign exchange transactions will classify as either trade or non-trade. Either is export, import. Non-trade means remittances, inward, outward remittances, trade, ECBs, all these things, okay, we'll cover. So, you should know with because RBI, FEDA, DGFT, Indian customs, these are, DGFT and Indian customs are overseeing bodies of trade experts. RBI and RBI is overall in charge. FEDA issues guidelines for foreign exchange markets. And very important question, we're expecting one question, FIBIL, what is FBIL? Definite question, I think it's any less, 3-4 levels. FIBIL means Financial Benchmarks India Limited. FBIL is because LIBOR is going to be stopped now because we are trying to alternate benchmark rate. India now benchmark rates are not given by RBI. Most of you might be knowing, but those who are new to the forex, please note down. Reserve Bank of India stopped giving forex rates. Who is giving foreign exchange rates in India now? It is FBIL, Financial Benchmarks India Limited. They are giving the representative rate for all foreign currencies. Very important. They are also giving the rate of MIBOR. All market rates, notional rate, they are only giving. So these are the agencies in Forex. Na? Very important. RBI, FEDAI, DCFT, Indian Customs, FIBIL, ICC. ICC is International Chamber of Commerce. They govern world trade. All world trade is has to ensure compliance with ICC guidelines. So friends, this you see, because these are the regulations in foreign exchange. Okay. Then we go to foreign exchange dealings. Are very important. Exports, imports, inward remittances, outward remittances. Then because exports and imports trade related. Inward, outward remittances, maybe of any nature, love and affection, personal, education loans, all these things. Apart from it, one more layer is there. External commercial borrowings. This is very important. ECB guidelines. What is TC? Trade credit. FDI means foreign direct investment. FPI means foreign portfolio investment. FII means foreign institutional investment investors. Okay. We are expecting 3-4 questions from ECB, TC, FDI, masala bonds. Last time also the question came. All because today I will cover only basic aspects. Just to refresh yourself about forex. Next Saturday I will give you exam point of view all important topics. You should know the basics first. Saturday I will cover you exam point of view all questions. So we are expecting some questions from FDI, FPI part. What is the ceiling for FDI? Because a simple example, FDI can be in any enterprise. FPI can be only in this one, corporates only are registered now because they can't invest in a partnership firm like that. These are the basics. And we have up to 10%, it is called FBI. About 10, it is called FDI. This I will cover tomorrow, Saturday. So you should know what are the sources of foreign exchange dealings means. One is trade-based transactions, exports, imports. Other one is remittances part. Individual level, all the family level, all these things, remittances, no? What we are doing. Third one is lending, because investment and lending. It may be because we are a free country, we can also invest abroad. I can buy Facebook shares. I can buy a flat in Singapore. I can invest a company like that. Na? So imports, exports forms trade-related parts. Inward, outward remittances, remittances for other than trade, other than loans. Then ECB, travelers credit, this one, trade credit, FDI, FPI, ODA, all these, na, FIIs become, this is third, three dimensions you have to be, we should be thorough because there are three types of transactions, trade, remittances, this capital flows, because loan or investment flows, both outward and inward. So this is about we should, because we are expecting definite questions from ECB and this part. We'll exam point of view, I'll give on Saturday, okay? Then, very important, we are now, definite question, we are now following a unified exchange rate mechanism in foreign exchange. This is a definite question for at least 1-2 and 2-3. Because what is it? Because in foreign exchange, the basics of foreign exchange is exchange rate mechanism. How you are getting the rate? Suppose $1 is equal to how many rupees? How you fix? This is India now. Earlier, we are pegged to pound sterling, then currency basket, all gone. From exam point of view, India is following market-driven rate. That means it is called, technical word is, unified exchange rate mechanism India is following from 1993 August onwards. That means there will not be any intervention from the market RBI, because only when some barriers are breached, it will support, but there will not be any intervention. The rates are fully market driven. So this is a definite question you write down. Unified, the word is unified exchange rate mechanism. It is fully market driven. We have started, na, because before, Indian economy, as you know, can be classed. There are two eras in Indian economy. One is pre-1991, post-1991. Post-1991, we are liberalizing. Na? Para replaced FEMA. And major, very important change in Forex is, this is a definite question, we moved to unified exchange rate mechanism. In the common word, it is called market-driven. Till that time, everything is fixed by Reserve Bank of India only. Customers have no incentive. Exporters don't. Okay? Whatever rate RBI is, it's just the mercy of RBI. So 1993 is a watershed in year in Indian foreign exchange markets as we move to inward exchange. Then second one, convertibility of foreign exchange markets. This is also very important. What is meant by convertibility? This is also very important aspect. It indicates the restrictions in flow of foreign exchange. Because if it is advanced economies, USD or Europe, all that freely convertible. That means there are no regulations. I can do whatever I want. India also now moving to free convertibility, fully convertibility, but still we are some restrictions are there in capital print. So as of now, current account, we are fully convertible. Capital account, we are not fully convertible. This is simple, you should by heart, because there are two types of transactions in foreign exchange. Because from transaction point of view, two transactions are there. One is current account transaction, one is capital account transaction. What is meant by a current account transaction? Very important. I will share one more screen. You can hear, huh? Sir, okay? Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Okay. I will give one Saturday, sir. No, I will give everything prepared. Notes, you will. Because the notes is not there. This is only today, curtain rise, sir. I will cover it deeply and elaborate on Saturday, sir. Okay. I will make it slow. Okay. So friends, the fundamental time is there. Okay, the fundamental aspect of foreign exchange transaction is, I told you first, the exchange rate mechanism. Next one is how to distinguish. So the customer came to the counter, how to make it, because the permission levels, India is not fully convertible. Current account only we are fully convertible. Capital account we are not fully convertible, because convertibility is not there. Some regulations are there. So how to distinguish a transaction, whether it is a current account transaction or capital account transaction? Some example. Do you think the opening of an NRE account is a current account or capital account transaction? Normally, when we ask this question, 90% answers is a current account transaction, but it is a capital account transaction. So the meaning is, there are two types of customers from foreign exchange point of view. From FEMA angle, it is not Indian or foreign national. From FEMA angle, we only think whether it is a resident or non-resident. That I will cover next slide definition. As far as foreign exchange is considered, we are classifying the customers into two types of customers. One is resident, second is non-resident. He is not resident, Indian or non-resident. We are not bothered. The permissions are for residents and non-residents. They might be Indians or foreign nationals. So, and there are two terrains, India and foreign, abroad. So, there are two types of customers, resident, non-resident. There are two types of terrains, India, abroad. So, a current account transaction means, capital account transaction means, there must be a change in asset or liability of a non-resident in India. Suppose NRE customer, he is opening NRE deposit in India. What is happening? Deposit is an asset. Asset base is growing. NRE customer taking housing loan. Liability is growing. So like that, if any transaction results in change of assets or liabilities, including contingent liabilities, outside India for a resident or inside India for a non-resident, that is called capital account transaction. Very, very important. Once you understand, you can answer any question comfortably. Because capital account transaction, you should know. What is a capital account transaction means? This transaction, simple test. There are two parties, resident, non-resident. India, abroad. Resident, suppose I am buying a flat in Chennai. It's not a foreign exchange transaction because I am a resident. I am dealing in India only. My brother in US is buying a flat in US, New York. It is not a FEMA transaction because a non-resident dealing in abroad, no problem. Cross we have to finalize. Suppose my brother settled in US wants to buy a flat in Chennai. It's a capital account transaction because non-resident dealing in India, either asset or liability, any change. A transaction which results in change of assets or liabilities, loan or asset in India regarding a non-resident, is a capital account transaction. Some regulations are there. Similarly, any transaction which resulting in change of assets or liabilities of Indian residents abroad. Suppose I am buying I am residing in Chennai. I am buying shares of Facebook. My abroad assets are going up, investment going up. I want to buy a flat in Singapore. My assets are going up there. I want to take a loan from a Singapore DBS bank. I am taking an abroad loan. So this is the benchmark. So the very important, after exchange rate mechanism, Second important aspect of foreign exchange transactions is how to classify the transaction as current account or capital account transaction. So Saturday I will share you questions also in case studies like that. Today I could not prepare. I will discuss in question and answer format. So you just understand the concept because so in this case NRA account opening of NRA account is a capital account transaction. Why? Because non-resident Indian assets are going up. NRA account, NRA customer giving gift to his brother. It's a current account transaction because there is no change in assets and liability of the concerned fellows. So this is also very, very important aspect in foreign exchange transactions. So all other transactions are called current account transactions. So this is about nature of transactions. So there are two types of transactions. One is current account transaction. One is capital account transaction. With regard to current account transactions, everything is permitted in FEMA. Except they have given three schedules. That the logic is, in current account transaction, everything is permitted unless it is prohibited. That means only three schedules are given in current account transactions. If the transaction is not falling in the three schedules, it is deemed to be permitted only. So the maxim is permitted if not prohibited. This is a very, because we're expecting a question from this aspect. Current account transactions maxim is, FEMA says, it is permitted only. All current account transactions are permitted only, except if they are in the three schedules. There are three schedules. One is Schedule 1, Schedule 2, Schedule 3. That I will discuss on Saturday, okay? Just for, you know, today we'll go move ahead with the basics. When it comes to capital account transaction, the maxim is everything is prohibited. But they gave two schedules permitted transactions. Schedule 1 for residents, Schedule 2 for non-residents. This we have to understand. Whatever transaction we are putting through, first you have to segregate them into current account or capital account transaction, basing on the definition. Second, we have to analyze if the current account transaction means it should not be in the three schedules. If it is in the three schedules, that means otherwise it is permitted. For current account transactions, RBI through FEMA, under provisions of FEMA, has given three schedules. Schedule 1, Schedule 2, Schedule 3 of restricted transactions. Under capital account, RBI has given two schedules of permitted transactions. This aspect we must be careful. Under current account, everything is permitted except those three schedules which are prohibited. Under capital account transaction, everything is prohibited only except those two schedules which are specifically permitted. This is the maxim for current account and capital account transactions. So first important question is exchange rate mechanism. India is following unified exchange rate mechanism. Second is capital account transactions and current account transactions classification. Capital account transaction means any transaction which alters the liability or asset. Non-resident India, resident abroad. That is the asset test. That's all. Once you understand this concept, you can classify it. Current account, all transactions, India is fully convertibility is there. Everything is permitted, but on national interest, we have kept some transactions on prohibited list. Three schedules we will discuss later. Saturday, I will give the list in question answer format. That three schedules, if it is not there, you can go ahead. Capital account, everything is prohibited. But they gave two schedules which are permitted. One for non-residents, one for residents. This is about nature of transactions. Okay, then. Then quote. Next important aspect of foreign exchange is quote. How to quote a rate? Whether I have to quote $1 is equal to 70 rupees or 70 rupees is equal to $1 like that. There are two types of quotes globally in the forex market. And friends, they are called direct and indirect quotes. Direct quote, indirect quote also very important. As I told you, 1993 onwards, just like unified exchange rate mechanism, India is following direct quote mechanism only. This is also a very important question. Direct quote only we are following. What is meant by direct quote? What is meant by indirect quote? A direct quote means, suppose I want to buy one apple. What is the rate of one apple? I will get an answer that is 10 rupees, 12 rupees, like that. If I want to make money, what I should do? I have to buy apple at 10 rupees. I want to say I should sell the apple at 10 plus 1 rupee, 10 plus 2 rupees. So when you are quoting it, when you are dealing with direct quote, the maxim says buy low, sell high. Simple logic. If I buy one apple for 10 rupees and sell it for 9 rupees, I will make loss. If I buy one apple for 10 rupees and sell it for 11 rupees, I will make profit. That is direct quote. Indirect quote means I can ask, instead of asking the rate of one apple, I can ask how many apples I will get for 100 rupees. Here what happens? If I am getting 4 apples for 100 rupees, if I want to make profit, what I should do? I should sell only 3 apples for 100 rupees. Am I right? Indirect quote, the maxim is buy high, sell low. Logic, understood the quote. There are two types of quotes in foreign exchange market. Direct quote, indirect quote. In direct quote is just like asking what is the rate of one apple. Indirect quote, how many apples I will get for 100 rupees. So this variation, you know, if I am using direct quote, I should buy apple for 10 rupees, sell at 11 rupees. Buy low, sell high. If I am using indirect quote, I am buying 4 apples for 100. To make money, I should sell only 3 apples. Either here the maxim is buy high, sell low. But forget this theory only because maxim they ask. We are following India shifted to direct quote mechanism only from August 2nd, 1993. August 3rd, we unified exchange rate mechanism. August 2nd, direct quote mechanism. Here, Indian currency is always, now we are Indian rupees. We are, Apple will be the foreign currency. Indian market, we are following direct quote and foreign currency is our Apple. Just like, now, what is one USD, 70 rupees. What is one Euro, 80 rupees. What is one GBP, like that, greater than pound, US dollar. Like that, you ask only because our currency rate, we are following direct quote and always we quote the rupee in terms of foreign currency. Our apple is fixed. Our buying Indian rupees is fixed. Our apple, it is, if you want to buy apple, how much one apple, USD? If you want to buy pomegranate, how much one euro, like that. So we'll quote. Suppose the cost is very less, 1 paisa. You must ask how much, suppose you are buying some grains, 100 grains, how much rate, like that. So for weak currencies, like yen, all these things, we use 100 quantity. Other strong currencies, we use one quantity. Always we buy, in our quote system, rupees fixed, others vary. Because like, one USD, one INR 70, 100 yen, INR 10, like that. And always global currencies will follow 3-digit nomenclature. It is called ISO standard. So first 2 digits are, first 2 letters are country code. United States, IN, India. Third one is dollar, D dollar, R rupee, GBP, Great Britain, pound, euro, euro, like that. No? Always first 2 letters will indicate the country code. Last digit will indicate this one, the country currency. So it's a uniform standard. We follow the 3-letter nomenclature. So India is following direct quote. Our currency, we always quote foreign currency, Indian rupees. Foreign currency is our commodity there. It might be apple, pomegranate, like that. Now we ask, what is the rate of one USD, one euro, like that. And always the Indian system, a global system, we are following dual quote. We always quote simultaneously buying and selling rates. Very, very important. We will never quote a single rate. If I ask euro means, as per FedEx normal standard rules, I have to quote buying and selling. Bid and ask rate will call them. So I have to quote, left one is buying rate, right one is selling rate. So this difference is called spread. And we quote up to 4 decimals. Normally we have to quote up to, we will call pips, 4 decimals you have to quote. So India is following direct and dual quote system. Very important question. We are following a unified exchange rate mechanism. 2 types of transactions, capital and current account. Quoting system is direct and dual quote. and quote will be always up to 4 decimals. Buying will be left, selling will be right. These are the basics of, and at least one or two will come, because we have seen in foreign exchange risk management, all these patterns, verticals, the questions are very basic nature only. So we should not miss these easy marks. These are easy runs, single runs, na? Easy runs, easy scoring, we should not mix. Okay, this is about trade system. Any doubt? Okay, we'll move ahead. Then there are 4 tenor based trades, very very important. Ready purchase means we are buying immediately. That is called ready purchase rate. Then second rate is called TOM. Common mistake we are doing is TOM is not T+1. T+1 working day. Last time also they asked the question. Most 50% answered wrongly, because today's TOM will not be tomorrow. It will be tomorrow next working day only. Suppose Friday's TOM will be, Saturday is global holiday, Sunday holiday. So TOM is T plus next working day. T plus one means whenever the next working day only, you have to settle the transaction. That is very important. Spot means transaction today is happening. Next second working day, very excluding holidays, very important. This is a very important, because definite question is should. TOM and spot, you must be thorough. What is TOM? What is spot? There are 4 types of rates India preparing now. Globally also, ready purchase means immediate purchase, same day transaction will happen. Tomorrow means T plus one. It is not one day. It is one working day. So today, next working day only, the settlement will happen. Spot means next second working day only, settlement will happen. Globally, 90% of transactions will happen in spot mode only. Spot is the popular mode of settling the transaction. Then forward means, if the transaction is neither ready nor TOM, or it is not spot, we call them it is forward. Anything other than these 3 is called forward transaction. As of now, India, we are only hedging for 1 year. Forward contracts are for 1 year only. Okay. These are 4 important tenor based rates. Ready purchase, immediate settlement. Tomorrow means next working day. Spot means second working day. Anything else, it is called forward rate. This is about tenor based classification of rates. Okay. Then very important, transaction based buying and selling, very important. Whom to buy? Very common question. What to apply? Na? There are 2 types of instrument based. Na? Always any inward remittances, everything we apply TT buying. We call them ready purchase. TT buying, definite question. Telegraphic transfer buying is the common question they are asking. There are 4 types of rates based on classification of the instrument. Telegraphic transfer means equal to ready purchase only. That means we have money with us. TT purchase, it applies for all inward remittances, outward remittances you are sending for education loans, all these things. TT purchase, we call it. FC, FCTC, nobody is using now, because foreign currency and foreign travel restriction, we are using travel card. So theory only. And next one is bill. Foreign exchange bills, I will read on Saturday. Main important rates. Telegraphic transfer, bill, they are 2 very important rates. TT means immediate same day transaction happens, that you use for inward remittances, NRE remittances, or outward remittances you are doing today. Bill rate means you add some premium, so all you bill, any user's bill, side bill, under export or import, that is rate bill. And buying and selling, these 4 you buy hard, at least 2 to 3 questions I should. Last time also we share. This buying and selling, 2-3 questions definitely are coming, and TT and bill also definitely coming. So when to apply TT rate, when to apply bill rate, all bills you have to apply bill rate only. All remittances, inward remittance, NRE remittance, my brother sent a gift to me, I got it. All inward remittances other than trade, you have to apply TT. ECB also, you have to apply TT rate only. Except exports and imports, bill transactions, all others, advance remittance, advance payment received, all these things, very very important. Unless the bill word is there, the rate will be TT only. Telegraphic transfer is the common rate you have to apply, because whatever, or if it is a bill rate, these 2 you buy hard. In foreign exchange rate, what are the rates you have to quote? Then basing on transactions, we are having 2 transactions, buying and selling. So simple logic. Always exporters we buy. What are exporters? When party is having dollars, we buy from them. When party want dollar, we sell them. Simple logic. So easy remembrance. Export bill received, we buy from them. Exporter received advance payment, we buy from them. Importer is settling the bill, we sell to him because he has to pay in foreign currency. Importer is sending advance payment, we will sell him. Very, very important, simple logic. Export bill, what is the rate? TT, buying. Import bill, bill buying. Import bill, what is the rate? Bill selling, like that. You should have, no, I should have that you have to link. Advance payment received, it is TT buying. Bill is submitted, bill buying. Advance payment being sent, importers were sending money, overseas fellows. It is TT selling. So always simple, export by EBIS. EBIS, we just remember, exporters we buy EBIS, importers we sell. This is a benchmark, 2-3 questions issued. And TT means anything except bill, what is there? All other rates you use only TT buying or TT selling only. The simple how to remember is EBIS, we call it EBIS. EBIS, exporters buy, importers sell. Golden buy, this one you have to buy hard, that's all. And when regarding other transactions, inward remittances are equivalent to exporters. When I am receiving money from abroad, NRA is sending money, somebody is sending a gift. All inward remittances are equal to exporters. We buy from them. Same way, all outward remittances are equal to importers. Equivalent to out of our customers who are sending outward remittances, NRI customer is closing his NRI deposit, taking the money back. Outward remittance, it is selling only. We have to sell him. So this matrix you somehow by heart. Because I will repeat once again, but this grid is getting at least 3-4 questions in all levels. What is the rate applicable? Definite question in all 1-2, 2-3, 3-4. You must be thorough. It is, unless bill is included in the question, it will be TT rate only. Always from exporters, EB. Exporters we buy. So it will be TT buying or bill buying. IS, importers we sell. It will be TT selling or bill selling. That's all. This you by heart. 2-3 questions, assured questions will be there. In all levels we have seen, this buying rate is selling rate, definite questions are coming. EBIS you buy hard. And inward remittances are equal to exporters, outward remittances are equal to importers. This is very important, okay? Then very important concept, one common question, we know it, we are fumbling, very important. What is Nostro, Vostro, Loro accounts? These three, very, very important. Every exam, one question assured, all levels. So what is meant by Nostro account? The question is, the Nostro account is our account with them in foreign currency. Simple logic, na? Whatever forex transactions, last year question came like that. How the bank deal in foreign transactions? But doing foreign exchange transactions, we need an account. That is called Nostro account. Almost all our foreign exchange transactions are related to Nostro only. Rarely we use Vostro. Nostro account is nothing but our account in foreign currency. I want to deal in US dollars. Suppose my brother wants to send me dollars. How he can send dollars to Canara Bank? He will credit the amount in Canara Bank's account with some other bank in US or some USD account. So very important concept. Nostro account is our foreign currency account. But one fundamental aspect you should remember. Nostro account need not be in a foreign country. I can maintain my USD account in Mumbai also. I can maintain my USD account in Chennai also. Very important. One common mistake they are doing is, Nostro is of course our foreign currency account only, but it need not be always in a foreign currency, foreign land. Last IABF, they asked one question, IBA, this one. What is the nature of account? State by SBA, Canara Bank is having USD account with DBS Bank in Chennai. So it's a USD account only, even though it is in Chennai or London or Hong Kong, it is my dollar account. It is my Nostro account only. Very, very important aspect. Don't think that Nostro should be in foreign land only. It should be in foreign currency only. That is the logic. Nostro account means our foreign currency account. It might be USD, Euro, any, because Canara Bank, where foreign exchange is our strength, we are maintaining Nostro account in almost all major currencies. That is our strength. So Nostro account is always our foreign currency account. So Nostro account will never be in Indian rupees. it might be very important question. It might be in India also. Account can be, I can have USD account with Citibank Mumbai. I can have Euro account with Deutsche Bank Mumbai. It need not be in Deutsche Bank Germany only. I can have anywhere. But the account should be, currency should be either USD or GBP, or I can have a GBP account with HSBC in Delhi also. So the Nostro account means currency of the account will be in always foreign currency by heart. Ostro account means their account with us. Foreign banks also deal with Indian rupees. So they may be, so no Ostro account always will be in Indian rupees only. Nostro always foreign currency account of other bank, my, our bank. Ostro always will be with us only. Nostro is our account in some bank. Ostro is their account in our bank. So Ostro account, out of Nostro, Ostro, last time I asked you, which account will be with us? The question then you have to answer, na? Ostro account will be with us. Nostro will be our account with some other bank. So they are twisting this question, Nostro, Ostro, Loro concept, definite question at all levels. Clear? So this is also very important aspect. Nostro, understood, na? Always our foreign currency account with some foreign, with some bank. It might be anywhere in the world. Ostro means somebody's account in Indian rupees, some foreign bank's account in Indian rupees, in India or in abroad, because we may maintain a rupee account in our London branch also. Like that, na? Ostro means always Indian rupee account. It will be with us only. Nostro means always foreign currency account. It will be in some foreign bank. It may be anywhere. Location may be anywhere. We should not get bothered. The distraction. Last time one question came, I told you Canara Bank's USD account with some bank in Mumbai. It's Nostro only. Very, very important. The currency is only important. Location is not important. Because there are the twisting the same simple question. So always remember Nostro foreign currency with some bank, our account. Ostro with the account with us, IN rupee, INR only, of some foreign bank. So this is about Nostro, Ostro. Then what is Loro? Loro, because last time, because Nostro, Ostro, most of you might be knowing, but Loro, the concept is very important. What is meant by Loro? It is a Nostro account only. Loro is nothing but a Nostro account. It is not my Nostro account, my friend's Nostro account. Simple logic. Suppose Lakshmi Vilas Bank, Dhanlakshmi Bank, small banks, they can't have the privilege of opening foreign currency account in all foreign currencies. But they want to deal forex. What they will do? They will use Canara. Just like suppose somebody wants to tell you, send you some money. You don't have a bank account. What you say? Are you send my to my friend's account? He will give me. Like that. Okay, Lakshmi Vilas Bank is not having a dollar account. What they are telling? You credit to my Canara Bank account. He is my friend. He will transfer me. I have account with him. So Loro is also a Nostro account. It might be our Loro. We are, because normally we never depend on Loro account. We serve as a Loro to other customers, other banks. Being a big bank, we never use Loro account. Because almost all currencies we are having account. But we serve as a Loro account. Our account serves as a Loro account for most of the small banks, for many currencies. Okay, understood, na? Loro account is nothing but a Nostro account. Our Nostro account being used by some local banks here, always. That's all. So, Loro, so out of three accounts, Nostro and Loro will be always in foreign currency only. Ostro will be always Indian rupee only. Clear? So, this is about Nostro, Ostro, Loro. Okay. Then, we'll discuss about FEMA. I will discuss tomorrow. Then foreign exchange, FEMA tomorrow will discuss about the NRE deposit, everything I will cover tomorrow, because what is residential status I will cover Saturday morning, I will cover Saturday evening. Today we will cover it because other important topics from exam point of view, definite questions. Trade base, because foreign exchange, I told you, remittances, trade and other capital movements. Because there are three verticals, na? Remittances one part, trade one part, capital movement, because for FCR all these are there. that we'll cover later. First, today we'll specifically, because out of it, the trade part, we're getting more number of questions. Okay. Basics and trade part, very important. So, we'll quickly rush to trade aspects. So, one thing, as I told you, government Ministry of Finance is the authority for all foreign exchange transactions through FEMA, all these things. When it comes to trade, foreign trade, it is Ministry of Commerce and Industry, Department of Commerce, because these are the nodal agencies. Because the India's, because Ministry of Commerce, government manages India's foreign trade through foreign FTP, very, very important. Foreign trade policy is the document which stipulates the guidelines for our foreign trade. They will be, and India's foreign trade policy is Niryat Bandhu, export promoting policy, very important. And present for very important question, present 5-year foreign trade policy already expired in March 2020, already expired, but due to COVID we extended it till 31st March 2021. Very, very important, because extension of foreign trade policy, this is issued by Ministry of Commerce. It's a 5-year policy. Always we want to capture, our ambition is to capture 3.5% of global merchandise. These are our foreign, have you question answers to you in this aspect. These are the objectives of our foreign trade. We want to promote growth through exports. Niryat Bandhu. We want to even imports also. We want to minimize, or we want to use import only which are export promoting. Export promotion capital goods scheme means we want to import such items which will help in manufacturing in India. So, India's foreign trade policy, Niryat Bandhu, export promotion policy. 5-year policy, every year there will be 5-year policy. Current policy expired on 30th March 2020 and extended till 1 year, okay, due to COVID. Next, very, very important. Trade policy issued by Ministry of Commerce. The trade is governed by Directorate General of Foreign Trade. DGFT is the very important question. DGFT governs India's foreign trade. Very, very important. They implement the foreign trade policy. Who is the implementing authority of India's foreign trade policy? It is DGFT. Very important question. Directorate General of Foreign Trade is the implementing authority for foreign exchange trade related transactions. They implement and facilitate foreign trade of India. Very important. And the primary role of DGFT, very important question. It issues IE code to the customers. Okay. And without import-export code, we should not do any foreign exchange. We should not send any commodity outside India, any export-import. Only exemption, definite question is, suppose I am sending pickle to my brother. Is it export, sir? I am sending some gift to my brother. Is it export? Whether I need export code? We common. Our cousins were sending some flowers, pickles, food items, all these things. Whether they come under export, import. Is it possible? Whether IE code is required for such customers also? No, because this is very important. To export, import anything in India, we need IE code. But normal customers who are sending these gifts, love items, all these things, food items, pickles, any gift items, up to 5 lakhs, very important question, exemption is there for IE code. Not for trading. I can't export some goods. I am sending pickle to my brother. I am sending some food items, flowers to my brother. I am sending one gift item to my brother. If that item is not in ban list, up to 5 lakhs only, very important. I can send it without using IE code. Otherwise, anybody can't send do foreign trade without having valid IE code. That is called importer exporter code. IE code means, I will give question answer to you all this. I'll share the PPT and make it elaborate also. Just today, I want to rush and complete this trade aspect. So, it's Saturday and next Monday, we can have detailed exam point of view question answers. Unless you are thorough with the basics, we can't discuss, because that's why I'm rushing. Okay. Any doubts, you can share me to my WhatsApp number. I'll clarify you. Okay. IE code is mandatory for all types of exports and imports. Any customer who want to do export import, he needs IE code. But one, I told you some examples. We are sending gift to our family members. We are sending food items to family members. Whether it comes to export, is it tantamount to export? No. Government is given relaxation, up to 5 lakhs. Merchandise up to 5 lakhs. If it is permitted by Government of India, I can't send a dog here because something is not permitted, I can't send. all permitted items up to 5 lakh value consignment I can send without IECO to my close relatives, my friends, like that. Otherwise, importer exporter code is the major important. Without that, you can't do it. Then this is issued by DGFT. Second, the role of DGFT is they will maintain the list of ITC HSN codes. Very, very, very important. 3-star question, because definite question. ITC HSN means Indian trade classification. That means, because global trade, we will not call. It's a harmonized system is there. Harmonized system, nomenclature code for global merchandise. Globally, merchandise is not given trade by its name. All merchandise items across the world, they are classified by a code only. World customs issues merchandise code for all trading items across the globe. So merchandise, every shirt will have one code, 6-digit code. Pant will have one code. Specs will have one code, tie will have one code. Global merchandise, any merchandise trade across the globe, it will have 1 6-digit code. That is called merchandise code, commodity code. So shirt will be 000179. Chemicals, 112645, like that. Any item you tell, World Customs has given some 6-digit code. So in all export import document, that code only will come. There will not be any mention of shirt, pant, sweets, like that. So, India also, when you are dealing in the world, you have to follow the global system only. So, we are also following the same system. That is called, we are also naming the commodity as number. We are giving each and every commodity a number, unique number. That is called HSN codes. HSN codes, same codes you are using in your GST package also. Because everything is harmonized. So, this is called, that ITC we are ignoring, we are simply calling them HSN codes. HSN codes is nothing but commodity code. You see, any GST invoice, you see, they will mention HSN code only. You might be passing a lot of GSX, 06, all these things. You just see, all bills, they will mention HSN code. That is nothing but Indian Trade Classification Harmonized System Nomenclature. That means we are harmonized our coding with the global code. So that means globally each commodity is having 6 digits. India, we are having 8 digits. I will explain that. Globally, in global trade, each and every commodity will have a 6-digit unique numeric code. Numeric code only, number code only. When it comes to India, we are also following first 6 digits of global code for having much more clarification and MIS system. We added 2 more codes, appendix. Suppose that shirt is 00172. We are using 000172-01 cotton shirt, 02 polyester shirt, 03 nylon shirt, like that. So globally, any merchandise item will have a 6-digit numeric code. India, we are following a same 6-digit code plus 2. For Indian classification, we want much more data for data segregation. We are adding 2 more digits to the global code. And we are following 8-digit code. First 6 digits code, second 2 digits our DGFT is giving for having more detailed classification. So that is called ITC HSN code, Indian Trade Classification Organized System Knowledge Code for Merchandise. And third, what is the role of DGFT? Then they will issue, they will, basing on the foreign trade policy, they classify the merchandise. One is IE code, second is merchandise code. Third is classification code. Everything is not freely permitted for export import. Now coming to the IE code, earlier used to give separate code, but 2014 onward, they are giving PAN number only IE code. Just to avoid multiplication of these codes, when you apply your IE code, they will tick you, they will give IE code, but the code is your PAN number only. So IE code is now alphanumeric 10 digit. ITC HSN code is, I told you, numerical code with 8 digits, first 6 from World Customs, last 2 Indian subclassification. Then third, very important question, classification for merchandise. There are 4 types of categories. One is free. If the merchandise, before, you can go to DGFT website, how they maintain for each and every ITC list. 95 lists are there, you can see. Each and every item ITC code, they will give description and they will write free, restricted, canalized, prohibited. There are four types. If it is free, there is no need of license. You can export any number of any amount of quantity you can export. You can import also. If it is restricted, this ITC code they have given import and export also. They are in DGFT website, they will give the schedule of all ITC codes, merchandise, for imports and exports. And they will classify them into four types. Each and every ITC code, they issue any one of the code. If they write free means that item import or export. Whether it is imported, they write free means import is freely permitted. Export free, they write means export is freely permitted. When write restricted, that means license is required. You can't export import without license. FRCP, they are the four codes for merchandise, foreign exchange, foreign trade. Free means no barriers, no license required. Restricted means license is required, export license required, import license required. This you have to verify. Very important question. C means it is not prohibited, it is canalized. We call them STE, state trading enterprise only can deal with it. MMTC like that, na? Some items all can't deal. Uranium, all this, some items, na? They are canalized items. Canalized items, whether you can deal? You can deal only when your customer is a PSU or a permitted state trading enterprise. This is a very important question. Classification code for merchandise, very, very important. One question issued. Indian, all merchandise were classified four types. Free, restricted, canalized, or bracket ST you can put, prohibited. Free means no barriers, no license required, anything I can do. This list is dynamic. As I told you, government, suppose onions, we have scarcity. Government will make it free to restricted. Then you can't export because this is a dynamic list. This month it will be free. You see HCQ tablets, Trump passed us, earlier we banned it, we then released. Like that, this is a dynamic list. Merchandise classification list is a dynamic list. This month it may be free. Sugar, 1 month it will be free. If glut is there, they'll allow exports. If scarcity is there, they'll make it restricted. They'll prohibit also. Like that, this is very important. So DGFT is having triple role. One is issuance of IE code. Second is issuance of maintenance of ITC HSN code. The same code you are using for our transactions also, domestic GST transactions. That is ITC HSN, Organized System Nominator Code. It is a 8-digit code in India. US may use 10, but whatever country uses, first 6 are from global world customs only. Remaining all you can add, you should not, otherwise you can't export because global world customs recognizes the merchandise by the first 6 digits only. Very, very important question. Merchandise world customs will have 6-digit code. Basing on the country requirements, you can add any number of codes. India is following 8-digit ITC HSN codes. And classification, we're having 4 types of classification: free, restricted, canalized, prohibited. Prohibited means you should not touch that item. You should not permit the trading in that item. Any import or export, you just go through ITC code. It is writing P there. Sir, bus are prohibited, bus, you can't do it. So exam point of view, very important question. These three, and very important, now IE code, they're issuing PAN number as IE code. Very, very important question. PAN is becoming their IE code, okay? Then one more important. Last time as it came, customs is the physical interface. DGFT is the policy interface of the foreign trade. Customs is the physical interface. Customs ensure that the export-import transactions are following the Government of India guidelines. They are complying. They are tax compliant. All will be managed by customs. And customs levies 3 duties. One is basic customs duties. Second is anti-dumping duties. Third is countervailing duties. Last time it came, 4 to 5 it came, 3 to the what is countervailing duty it came. Very important. Customs duty is levied on all items. I export and import now, best tariff. Normally, all items. Exports, some items. Imports, all items, they levy. Anti-dumping duty is a duty levied to prevent cheap imports. Suppose China is, suppose a penny is costing 10 rupees here. China, it is costing 5 rupees. They are dumping all their pens. What happens? Our industry collapses. So to prevent low cost imports, which are compared to cheap imports, we will levy anti-dumping duties. Very, very important. Then what is countervailing duty? Very important. Suppose you take an example of New Zealand. They will give huge subsidy to dairy industry. Some European countries, they are giving subsidies to dairy industries. So the cost of milk production is less than 50 there. India, where milk cost 1 liter is 50. There, because of government, cost of production is not low, but because of subsidies, the cost is low. So 20 rupees subsidy they are giving, it is 30 rupees only it is costing. India is 50 rupees. When they are spreading overseas milk here, what happens? Our dairy will be killed. So to prevent subsidized imports, we can levy countervailing duties. Very important. This is a definite question. 3 to 4 and 4 to 5, very important question. Anti-dumping duty is levied to prevent import of low-cost items. That means the cost of production is less compared to our industries. There you can levy anti-dumping. Where you can levy countervailing duties? When the host country, exporting country, cost of production is not less, but they are giving subsidies to make the product cheaper. So in simple words, anti-dumping duty, low-cost import prevention tool. Countervailing duty to prevent export of or rampant import of subsidized items heavily. That means to say these two duties are to safeguard our industries. Parallel 3 to 4, 4 to 5, definite question. My anti-dumping and countervailing duties, you just go through it. You will share question also next week. That's a lot of questions. So these three tariffs, customs is, you have to ensure that you should know what is customs duty, anti-dumping duty, and CBD, countervailing duty. Anti-dumping to prevent low-cost items where manufacturing cost is low to safeguard our industry. Countervailing duties to prevent import of rampant import of subsidized items where cost of production is not low, but they are spreading because of subsidies. Very important. Okay. Then friends, it is 9 o'clock. We'll start. We'll just have one more slide. Then we'll go ahead. Very important. Apart from these, world trade is governed by, I'll just take 5 minutes only, friends. I know, like, your dinner is waiting for you. So world trade, now apart from local restrictions, ICC is publishing 7 documents. A lot of documents they'll be publishing. From exam point of view, these 7 are very important. First, Incoterms, it is 2020 version. There are 11 terms. I will discuss Saturday in detail all these things. Incoterms 2020, remember, very important because change happened from 2010. Now they have replaced 11 terms, international commercial. Incoterms means international commercial terms. I will discuss, I will cover. Either Saturday, if it's not happened, I will stretch to Monday also because in Forex, 15 easy questions assured. Be thorough, sir. Topic is very less, not that much big topic. Interesting and simple topics, you get at least 15 questions there. Okay, Incoterms, as an ICC exam point of concern, you must know Incoterms governs the dealings of transaction. Who has to buyer responsibility, what seller responsibility, they will tell. Buyer has to bear, who has to bear transportation cost, who has to do all these things are governed by Incoterms. World trade is happening because of ICC only. Next, UCPDC 600, Uniform Customs and Practice of Document Rates. UCPDC 600 is the latest version. This is a common question they are asking. UCP 600 issues guidelines or issuance of LC. Then URR 725, these numbers you by heart, because latest version they are asking. Uniform rules for reimbursement, bank to bank reimbursement, 725. ISBP 745, these 6 you by heart. 6 items are there. You have to somewhat by heart. Incoterms 2020 is the latest version. UCP it is 600. URR, Uniform Rules, Bank Rules for Reimbursement, it is 725. Just like collection items are sending, the rules are there. ISBP is International Standard Banking Practice 745. URDG, Uniform Rules for Demand Guarantees 758. These numbers you somehow by heart because one question issued. Incoterms 2020, UCP 600, URR 725, ISBP 745, URDG 758, and Document Dispatch Rules 872. These six numbers you by heart, particularly 1 to 2, these are very important. 2 to 3 also they may be asking. So, these numbers, latest version of ICC terms, where these six, these are the six statements which are governing world trade. Very important from exam point of view. Okay. Incoterms 2020, UCP 600, URR 725, ISBP 745, URDG 758. UCP is for LCs, URR is for collection items, how to reimburse all these things. ISBP is nothing but elaboration of UCP, it guideline, International Standard Banking Practices 745. URDG is 758, this is the latest number. Document Dispatch Rules 872. These numbers, who are going to 1 to 2 definite question assured. 2 to 3 also will assure some questions. 3 to 4 they may ask in depth about Incoterms. I will cover on Saturday. So friends, it is 9 o'clock. We'll wind up. I will cover in Saturday and Monday. Because we have to need two more sessions. Saturday I will continue with basics. Monday will cover export import aspects. And I assure you at least 15 questions from the Forex. Okay. We'll wind up, sir. Want to continue? Better 9 o'clock, na?
One second, sir. I'll check up with the people. Sir, shall we wind up? I am requesting participants to answer whether we can continue or wind up. I think, Satish, sir, one or two people are asking to continue. So if you have some more slides, you can continue, sir. Hello.
Sir, I will prepare notes for them on Saturday and give it, sir. So, all these terms. I can continue, sir. I am ready.
Wait. You can continue for another 15 minutes.
15 minutes, sir? Okay. I will continue, sir. No problem. I'll continue, sir. Thank you, sir. I'll continue. Okay, I'm ready, sir. Okay. Friends, we can continue for just 15 minutes. I will take. Don't delay our lunch, dinner. We'll just wind up one topic, okay? Friends, I told you, these six are global terms. It is very important from 1 to 2 and 2 to 3. 3 to 4, they may ask in depth about Incoterms. I will cover on Saturday and Monday. Then, very important, common definite questions for all levels. Because very important, India is a fair country. Because how any decision is to be taken, we just think that we are one of the fairest countries in foreign exchange transactions. Okay. We don't want others' money. We don't let others to loot us. So, simple logic. When you are exporting something, we want our money back. India's wealthy. How to analyze the transaction degradation? When something is going, you are exporting something, India's wealth is going out. You have to get money back. When you are importing something, I am getting foreign wealth. I don't want free of cost. I will settle the debt. So India is a very transparent country. Normal parlance is, if I am exporting something, you pay me. I sold you goods. You pay me within 6 months. I am importing something from you. You sold me something. You settle the transaction within 6 months. Golden premise is 6 months you have to settle the transaction as the exports or import. We have to settle the transaction. But exceptions are there. But the logic is India don't want to get looted. When I am sending something exporting to you, you must pay me within 6 months. Same way I will pay you. When anybody is importing some goods, the logic says he must settle the bill within 6 months. Exceptions we are giving. But basic premise is, don't prolong your export receipts or import settlement. This is the golden premise. And we are doing trillions of transactions. How India is monitoring? Because trade is a source of money laundering, source of all nefarious activities. So we are having a state of art system. Proof of export is common question in 1 to 2 ZR. What is a proof? When you are exporting something, customs is the interface. I told you, customs is the DGFT is the governing body, policy making body, policy implementation agency for trade. Customs is the physical interface for merchandise. So when you are exporting something, what is the proof? Customs will issue you ZR or shipping. We call it shipping bill. Shipping bill or GR is the proof of exports. Same way, what is proof of import? Bill of entry is the proof of import. Customs will be issuing a shipping bill or bill of entry. Exporter, it is shipping bill. Or ZR we call it. Importer, it is bill of entry. So, when the, as I told you, when GR shipping bill is there, you have to get inward remittance. I sold you goods. India's wealth went out. It should be matched with inward remittance. Either advance payment or bill payment. I must get payment. When bill of entry is there, I must match it with outward remittance. I don't want others' wealth. I sent out advance payment. Get the goods. Get submit bill of entry. I already get received bill of entry. I imported the goods. Pay money. Initiate outward remittance. This is a very important premise. GR should be matched with the inward remittance. Suppose you got advance money, you send ZR. Same way, bill of entry is there, send outward remittance. If you already sent advance payment outside, get import the same and submit bill of entry. This is the basis of Indian foreign exchange transactions. Exam point of view or your operations point of view, this logic understand. You should understand. I'm importing, pay money. I'm exporting, get money. This is the logic. Okay. So then how we are matching from exam point of view, na? There are four portals, very important. 1-2-2 ICE gate. What is ICE gate abbreviation? You should know. Indian Customs EDI gateway or e-gateway, we call it. Indian Customs Electronic Gateway or EDI gateway. ICE gate, common definite question for 1-2-2. It is the portal which is helping. Indian Customs is fully online now. Exporters can log in. Importers can do whatever you want, you can do. Under ICE gate, we are having two systems. EDPMS, IDPMS, definite questions for 1-2-2, 2-3. Definitely they will ask because our bank is having a lot of pending entries also. What is ICE gate? Definite question. Indian Customs Electronic Gateway or EDA Gateway. EDPMS, Exports Data Processing and Monitoring System. IDPMS, Import Data Processing and Monitoring System. What is FETES? This is package of banks to RBI. Foreign Exchange Transactions, Electronic Reporting System. These four packages, one question assured. So, how India is managing foreign trade, you see, whenever import or export is there, using them, what happens? India, almost all ports are integrated. Electronic EDI ports only we call them. Either land port, sea port, or in containers. Only 34 ports are in manual. That is in Nepal area, Nepal, Bihar border, China. Otherwise, all ports, either airport or seaport, ICDs, they are fully online. Indian Customs is fully online. So, whenever you do an export transaction, through EDPMS package, Customs will transmit the data to RBI. From RBI, all banks will get the data. So, whatever my exporter is exporting, that GR number will come to me through EDPMS package. Very important. So, whatever my importer is importing, that bill of entry data will come to me through IDPMS package. So, EDPMS and IDPMS are the portals from Customs, link Customs, Bank, RBI, Banks, Linkage, DGFT. Four PECs are there in EDPMS, IDPMS packages. So, it's a flawless, seamless flow of data from Customs to RBI, RBI to Banks. So, we are totally hooked. Earlier, unless party submits the GR, we are dark, we are in dark. No, not like that. The moment party exports something, the GR will populate you in your system. It is seamless flow of data. So, EDPMS, IDPMS, definite questions. So, through EDPMS package, I am knowing the GR status of my customers. Through IDPMS package, I am knowing the bill of entry status of my customers. So, understood? RBI, so in through this way, we are knowing what are the GRs in India. Bill of entries in India. Then through FETES, Foreign Exchange Transaction Reporting System, all branches, banks, we are sending the details of all inward and outward remittances, maybe trade, maybe remittances, maybe capital flows to RBI, Reserve Bank of India knows what are the inflows, what are the outflows through India. Very important, through FETUS package. So what we have to do? Any EDPMS is there, match with inward remittance. Any bill of entry is there, match with outward remittance details in this package. This code you have to punch there. Then it will be squared up. If bill of entries are pending, RBI trends, bill of entry follow-up statement. BEF statement, definite question for 1 to 2 to 3. Bill of entry follow-up statement is a statement which follows where bill of entry is not submitted when payment already made. Export, XOX is the export bill outstanding statement. XOX. Export bill outstanding. Statement indicates GRs not paid. Already amount, our Indian mercantile, but amount not paid. In bill of entry follow-up, you have sent amount, mercantile not received. So this we are managing. So what are the packages saying, helping? ICEGATE, EDPMS, IDPMS, FETUS. These four packages, definite questions assured. This way, India is managing its foreign exchange transactions. Okay. Then one more thing, friends, very important question. Recently, RBI, Government of India told any FCRA, foreign currency, they have changed. Any NGOs, they want to get any foreign remittance, they have to route through from SBI main branch in Delhi only, all foreign currency, FCRA remittances. Very, very important. No other bank can deal with it. They mean State Bank of India, New Delhi main branch as a nodal branch for all FCRA donations. Very important, definite question, all levels. We have framed in here because we have, in our course also we have covered, FCRA, recent amendment, all payments have to be routed through State Bank of India, New Delhi, main branch. From there only, because very important, it's very important modification and it is definite question in all levels. So you can't handle FCRA remittances directly now. State Bank of India, main branch has to deal. Now, today we'll just cover about this swift and we'll wind up. Okay, then I told you global trade is highly systematic. One end it is ICC, International Chamber of Commerce, through its all ICC norms, all these things they are controlling, they are giving all structural framework, UCPDC, Dockless rules, all these things. Second one is now swift. Swift is also playing a globally very important role in foreign exchange trade. Because in foreign exchange transactions, what is meant by SWIFT? Common question it may come because Society for Worldwide Interbank Financial Training Communication. Okay, so it may not, they may not ask. SWIFT is having common question. Last time it came from 4 to 5. SWIFT is having 9 types of messages. Very important. SWIFT messages will be always empty followed by 3-digit. SWIFT message format, definite question. It is alphanumeric. Alpha is common. True letters, empty. Message to mail transfer, empty is common. The numbers may be from 101 to 999. SWIFT message. SWIFT is the authenticated digital courier service. Very simple. Without SWIFT, we can't imagine foreign exchange transactions. SWIFT is not, it's a test key based. It is not cryptographic. Very important question. SWIFT is not based on cryptography. It is test key based. Very important question from 1 to 2 to 3. SWIFT messages are based on test key system, not cryptography. Very important. 100% question, definite question, assured question. SWIFT. So, SWIFT is having 9 types of messages. All messages are named as empty only. Number will follow from 101 to 999. But in branch level, by exam point of view, you must know what is, in bank also are using only empty 100 series, 200 series, and then we are using a 700 series. Remaining all not required. At the exam point of view, this theory only. So, very important common message is empty 103 funds transfer. Definitely one question. Empty 103 is the funds transfer message. It is just like issuing check. When you receive empty 103, our Nostro account gets credited. Common question. When you are sending empty 103, our Nostro account will get debited. This is the question they are asking. When I am issuing empty 103 means I am issuing a check. My account will get debited. Empty message, empty 103. Swift message means it is just like SFMS, global SFMS. ICC and SWIFT are the two eyes of world trade. SWIFT is the messaging system. It is just like Ramban. Once you release, it's gone. It's only messaging system. It is not a, unlike RTGS, NEFT, SWIFT is not a payment system. Very important question. Whether SWIFT is a payment system? No. SWIFT is a messaging system only, just like SFMS, it's a messaging system. You can only give instructions. But once you give instruction, gone. Money will go. If you are issuing MT-103, you are issuing instruction to pay to some X. That's gone. Your account will be debited automatic. Everything seamless. You are receiving 103 means somebody's account got debited, your account got credited. So SWIFT is only a messaging system and it is based on this test keys, not cryptography. Very important. These two questions, definite questions. And SWIFT is having 9 types of messages. And common message MT-103, MT-202. If you are issuing means, our Nostro account will get debited. If you are receiving means, our Nostro account will get credited. MT-103 is the common message for funds transfer. Funds transfer is MT-103. Please buy heart it. NRE remittance will come. What is the message you are getting? MT-103. You want to close NRE deposit and send it. You have to issue MT-103. You have to pay fees, college fees. You have given educational loan to a customer. What is the message for transferring fees? It is a issuance of MT-103. Very important. You are closing FCNR deposit. Party wants the remittance. It is issuance of MT-103. You are MT-202 is bank-to-bank transfer. So MT-103, 202 are messagings for funds transfer. One is customer transaction, second is bank. Issuance means your account is being debited, check issue. Receiving means you are getting a check, your account will get credited. Then next messages are MT-700 message. MT-700 is LC. Issuance of LC 700. Amendment of LC 707. Issuance of bank guarantee 760. Amendment 767. These six messages you by heart. One question issued. MT-103 funds transfer. MT-202 bank to bank transfer. MT-700 issuance of LC. MT-707 amendment of LC. MT-760 issuance of bank guarantee. 767 amendment of bank guarantee. These six messages, one question issued. And SWIFT is having 9 types of messages. And the normal pattern will be MT from 101 to 999. Clear? This is about SWIFT.
Yes, sir.
Sir, may I continue for some more time, sir?
Yeah. And can you repeat the numbers?
Repeat numbers, sir. Okay, sir. Repeat the numbers, sir. Yes. So, after what time I can stretch, sir, then I will cover some other topics, sir. Okay, no problem, sir. Okay, okay. Okay, we'll cover these transactions. Okay, sir. So, friends, I told you, global trade is highly, daily trillions of transactions are happening. Why? Because two important systems are there. One is ICC, International Chamber of Commerce. They are issuing 6 documents. Popular, I told you, popular documents. Same way, SWIFT is also other peg. One is a rule book is ICC. Messaging, because proper communication is required. SWIFT serves as a authenticated communication system for bank to banks. The name is Society for Worldwide Interbank Financial Telecommunications. SWIFT message is having a 5-digit format. The format is 5-letter format. It is MT followed by number. 2-digit alpha, 3-digit number. It is from 101 to 99. Lot of messages are there, 9 types. But bank we are only following the 2 types. These 3 only popular. MT-103, funds transfer, very important. And very important question is, SWIFT is not a payment system. You must remember it. Common question they asked you last time. They asked 4 to 5, they asked whether SWIFT is a payment system. No. SWIFT is not a payment system like RTGS, NEFT. It is only a messaging system like SFMS. You can only use payment instruction. Whether check is a payment system? No. Check you are giving only instruction to pay like that. SWIFT is a messaging system, not payment system. but the message you are giving is authenticated. If once you give 103 means, they will definitely debit your account. Once you get 103 means, they will definitely get your account. Once you like that, first message is empty 103. That is funds transfer request. When you want to close the NRE deposit, you have to send funds through empty 103 only. When customer wants to open, he will send empty 103 only, like that. Any, if you want to send, if you want to remit school fee, college fees to EL education, EL party, abroad EL party, how to send? It is through empty 103 only. Same way, any bank to bank transactions, it is empty 202, empty 202, 202. Inward or outward? Inward means creditor, outward means debitor. Okay, very important. Empty 103 received. What is the effect in Nostro account? Common question they are asking. Empty 103 received means our Nostro account will get credited. Simple logic. You are getting empty 103 or 202 means you are getting a check from somebody. When you are issuing empty 103 or 202 means you are giving a check to someone. So when you give check to someone, what happens? Your account will get debited. So when you are issuing 103 or 202, common question, your Nostro account will get debited. When you are receiving 103 or 202, definite question, your Nostro account will get credited. They're asking question like that. When I issue empty 103, what happens to my Nostro account? Account will get debited. When I receive empty 103, what happens to my Nostro account? Account will get credited. Same way, empty 707 or 707, very important. Empty 7 sequence. Empty 700 is issuance of LC, letter of credit. Empty 760 is issuance of bank guarantee. 767, 707, amendments. These six, definitely one question will come. Empty 103, 202, 700, 707, 760, 767. These three format. And in all, 799 is a free format message, authenticated message. So these you by heart. Okay, friend, this is very important. Okay, now we go to some time is there. I will just show you regarding the permitted list, current account transaction, I'll simply cover, okay? I told you, in current account transactions, this is very important. The current account transaction we'll discuss. Current account transaction, I told you, everything is permitted. We are fully convertible. But government, for national importance, something they have barred. Otherwise, current account is fully permitted unless prohibited. I told you three schedules are there, prohibited schedules. First one is issuance of foreign currency. Foreign exchange is banned for Nepal, Bhutan, and Schedule 1 transactions. What are fully banned transactions? Schedule 1 transactions and transactions involving Nepal, Bhutan or citizens of Nepal, Bhutan. These fellows you should not do. Fully banned. Schedule 2. What is Schedule 1 transaction? Will give list to tomorrow. I'll give the list to you. Lottery remittances. These remittances should be fully banned. Either transaction is in Schedule 1 or Nepal to Bhutan. Fully banned. No one can permit it. If the transaction is in Schedule 2 transaction, the list I have given, nine transactions are there, like remittance of print, giving advertisement in foreign media. Suppose Ilayaraja sir is going to conduct a troop in a music party in Singapore. You can permit a simple transaction only, but any cultural troop requires a Ministry of Culture permittant, HRD permittant, like that. In Schedule 2, I will give the list tomorrow, Saturday. If the transaction is in Schedule 2, Government of India has to permit. There are 11 transactions there. If the transaction is in Schedule 3, RBI can permit. This is very important. For current account transactions, everything is permitted. But only three prohibited entries are there. First one is Schedule. They have given Schedule 1. Schedule 1 transactions, I will give the list to you on Saturday. And issuance of foreign currency to Nepal, Bhutan, fully prohibited. No one is having power to deal with it. Schedule 2 transactions, If the transaction is in Schedule 2, some 11 items are there, it is not prohibited. But to permit such transaction, you need Government of India's respective department's permission. Suppose, example, I want to send ocean freight. I need Ministry of Shipping permission. I want to transfer rent to telecom transponder. I am a TV. I am having a satellite TV. I am from Sun TV. I want to remit a transponder rent. I need Ministry of Broadcasting permission. Like that, in Schedule 2 transactions, the transactions are not banned, but regulated. Who has to permit? Government of India departments have to permit. Various ministries, they have given permission. Suppose I want to advertise in foreign media. Permission required. I want to pay rent to a transponder. Permission required. I want to conduct a cultural trip abroad. Permitted only, but permission required. Those are called Schedule 2 transactions. I will give you the list on Saturday. Then, third list is Schedule 3 transaction. It is not banned. It is also regulated. But the permission is not with Government of India. Even Reserve Bank can permit. 4 or 5 transactions are there. I will discuss. So, under current account transactions, these are the 3 lists are there. One is Schedule 1 and travel to Nepal, Bhutan. Fully banned. Second schedule, permitted, not fully permitted, but permitted subject to Government of India clearance. Third schedule transactions, permitted only, but you need RBI concurrence. What are the transactions? I will tell you. Schedule 1, 9 are there, 2 are there. I will give the list to you on Saturday because time is not there. Same way, when it comes to current capital account transaction, there are 2 schedules. Those I told you, those are permitted. In current account, these 3 are prohibited. Remaining all permitted. When it comes to capital account, those 2 schedules are there. One schedule is for resident, Indian residents. Second schedule is for non-residents. That is prohibited list. Permitted list. Here, it is prohibited list. So, these are about foreign exchange. Then, time is there, we'll just cover a resident. So, we'll continue, sir.
Yeah, please.
Please, okay, I'll continue. Okay. We will discuss about this residential status also. So, another very important aspect is the status of resident. Normally, we think that resident India means residential status is not only for individuals because all know it. Under section, which section? Common question is, PEMA is, don't think that PEMA is a big book. PEMA is a small booklet, just 20 pages booklet with 49 sections only. You can read if you want time. But exam point of view not required. SEMA, if they ask, it is not a big book. How many sections PEMA means? 49 sections with just small booklet, 20 pages only. But compliance required a lot of efforts. So, under section, which section classifies residential status? Definite question. It is section 2V. In section 2, point number V, last but one point, it is there. Very common because they are asking the section, definite question. 1 to 2, 100% question. Under section 2V, V for Victorina, 2V, or you remember that V for Visa. Under section 2V, this residential status is defined. And residential status for individual, I told you very important, it is 182, not 182, it is 183 days. It is above 182 days means party should be in India for at least 183 days to get that. I will discuss because exceptions are there. But apart from this, common question now they are asking is because individually, no, non-individual also residential status is there. What are they means? Any person or body corporate, Indian company always will get, because these 3 very important, residential and individual all knows. That's why they are not asking that question. Now, very important is residential status regarding non-individuals. Definite questions for 2 to 3, 3 to 4. These 3 are the items. Any person or body corporate, registered in or incorporated in India, that means Indian registered company, Indian registered any enterprise, they will get only residential status. They can't get non-resident status for PEMA angle. Very important. Same way, an office or branch or agency in India, you are having office, but it is controlled by a person non-resident. even then he will get residential status only. Very important point. Any branch, office, agency in India controlled by a person non-resident, it may be foreign national or NRI, but since the place of is Indian, so any foreign exchange transaction we treat them as resident only. Very important, because individuals we know 183 days on this, they are not now. These three points we are expecting definite question in this promotion test. So third way, any office, branch, agency outside India but owned by Indian person, these three entities also non-individual residential status. These three are the definitions. Very, very important. Individual, you know, 183 days plus. Non-individual, large individual, it is section 2. All these are defined in section 2V. 2 visa, I remember. Very important question. Sir, I can wind up. Yes, sir, is there? It is there, nothing. It is there.
Not if branch or agency in India owned or controlled by a person
resident outside India, sir. Yes, sir.
Non-resident.
Any non-resident, sir. Yes, sir. He gets resident status only, sir. Yes, sir. Okay, sir. When it is over, you just have just quiet, sir. So, friends, these three very, very important decisions from exam point of view, because we're expecting one question for out of all these 3 points at all levels. What is the residential status for non-individuals? Very important. They will get residential status. These three categories always should be considered residents only. First one, any Indian registered company or enterprise will always be resident only. Very important question. Second, wherever I am, I am an NRI, I am a foreign national, but if I am doing business, office, branch, agency in India, means I will be considered as resident only. This is not from IT angle, from FEMA angle, we are telling. Transactions in foreign exchange, we will consider them as resident only. Very, very important. Any office, branch, agency in India, owned or controlled by, not only, if controlled, it is called as resident. We'll give them resident status only. Same, because the logic means I am an NRI, I am doing business in India, I must comply with FEMA guidelines as a resident only. Same way, this the fourth point, very important. An office, branch or agency outside India but owned or controlled by person India, resident India, it also gets residential status only. Very important. Suppose I am setting an office in Mauritius, I am setting office in Cayman Islands, I am setting office in Dubai, just to avoid tax. No. For all foreign exchange transactions, since I am the owner, I am the controlling person, that will get resident status only. Very important. These 2, 3, 4 points, I think we will get in 2, 3, and 4 levels in promotion process. Because everyone knows section 2V, first point. All knows 180 days plus. Because they are the same point they are asking. So, this is a very important aspect. You must go through it. Okay? So, this is so any person visited India. Second one, any office in India, controlled or owned by outside India. But we are not bothered. Indian office means Indian resident only. Then, Indian fellow, Indian resident, he is manning or operating office abroad. I will treat him as Indian resident only. From FEMA angle. These three, remember. Okay. If time is there, Anand sir, if time is there, I'll go for this Incoterm, sir.
Sir, it's already 9:30. Sir, we will wind up, sir, for today. Sir, we will wind up for today.
We will wind up, sir. Okay, okay. Okay, sir. I will take Saturday and Monday, sir. Okay. Yeah. Connect. Okay, sir. Can I announce, sir? You will announce it, sir?
Yeah.
I will announce it. Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Today we will wind up for the day. We will continue on Saturday. My request to Siva Satish, sir, is kindly share the PPT in advance to the candidates.
Sure. Definitely, sir. I will share it, sir.
If you can share the PPT for today's class and the Saturday's class, I will put in the group so that they can have in their mobile or printout whatever manner they want to have. So that
Definitely. I will share it, sir. Okay, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, friends. All the best.
Good night, sir. All of you. Thank you.